We also showed that in many heads, including NAFLD, described it so well as one of us was speaking, thank you. And it also shows your involvement and despite your specialized areas. I'm also thankful to Dr. Pandit, who is professor, and I wish we had the opportunity to meet in person. I also welcome the whole team and the faculty, the staff, the residents, and maybe other people connected on this webinar. I thank our colleagues, Dr. Kapil and all others for having made this possible. I bring greetings from ILBS. I was supposed to cover on the major topic of NAFLD, but Kapil asked me that, well, COVID is still rampant and why don't you discuss something on impact of COVID on liver disease. This is an area which I think will broaden your horizon of NAFLD as well. Next, please. I have no conflict of interest, except that we have very bright, good faculty. Next, please. And also very good residents across the country. Next. I will try and cover COVID-19 and liver injury and its spectrum on healthy and a diseased liver. Next, please. Everyone is aware by now, I just want to put it for record purposes, that we are having a virus which is mutating very fast, and not only in its inner structure, but also on the express proteins. So we will have a continuing challenge of diagnostics, of the vaccines, and of the lethality, and therefore COVID will remain a vibrant challenge, a difficult challenge for next at least 2 years. Next, please. Everyone knows that it comes through the nose and involves the lung and the upper respiratory tract and causes several complications. But other than lung, this can cause complications which are thromboembolic, cardiac, endocrine, of course, neurological, renal, and I'll just touch upon some of the hepatic and GI, that it continues to have diarrhea and GI symptoms, loss of appetite. So what COVID does in a person who has a healthy liver versus what COVID does in a pre-existing liver disease patient. The complications can increase mortality, and therefore we have to understand whom to triage and how long to. The virus involves the lung. After lung, cytokines are released due to a damage by macrophages of the lung. And this releases several inflammatory cytokines and in fact can induce sepsis due to drugs, otherwise due to infection per se. For the liver and other organs, due to a lack of oxygen, you know, you're like, oh, patient needs oxygen. But the effect of that hypoxia is just not on the lungs or brain, but it is to all organs. And a hypoxia to the liver itself can cause huge challenges. You give all the drugs, whether it is remdesivir or it is antibiotic or steroids, they all can, and since they are metabolized in the liver, can cause liver injury. The blood flow in the liver decreases, and there are microthrombi in the liver sinusoids. This is something which we have to understand, that liver of these patients remains unhealthy for quite some time. Of course, the virus can do direct damage to the biliary epithelium. It actually multiplies as much probably as in the lungs in the biliary epithelium, but it is secreted. Generally, it doesn't cause, but it can in the mutant viruses. So there can be a multifactorial injury in an otherwise healthy liver. Next, please. So when you look at it from the lung, you have the virus which causes release of cytokines, hypoxia, congestions. These cells can cause liver injury, cytokines. The drugs can cause liver injury. You have several other problems. Next, please. So liver injury, by and large, is a bystander hepatitis. And I'll come and explain you sometimes what is a bystander. Next, please. And this is a direct cytopathic injury also. So let me explain what is a bystander hepatitis. For example, first time there is an injury due to the virus to the lungs. But once the antibodies are released against COVID or something, they will circulate and get settled into the liver. Now, next time, whenever there is a surge of the virus or there is a release, the liver sinusoids, which are having microthrombi, further injury will occur. And this is a bystander hepatitis. Liver is injured because it is holding on to the immune cells, which were released from the lung. So it's a bystander. Aap ja rahe hain raste mein, kisi ne maar diya aapko. This is the kind of injury. Now I will try and cover this spectrum in a normal liver, where rarely can be an acute liver injury, severe enough to cause acute liver failure.
Good afternoon. As Dr. Swasti sir is in an urgent meeting with DG sir, I'll be presenting on behalf of him. Ma'am, please allow me to slide share. And I'll be throwing some light on the integration of NAFLD into NPCDCS. Key strategies and operational aspect. On behalf of Dr. L Swasticharan sir, who is additional DDG and director EMR. So it started when India started responding to the NCD challenges with vertical national program in 1975. We started it as a pilot in 10 districts by 2018, and NPCDCS program was implemented in 100 districts of 21 states by 2010. In 2013-14, the integration and with NHM and rollout in 36 states and union territories was done, and in 468 districts and counting in 2015 and 16. The paradigm shift occurred in 2018 with a comprehensive primary healthcare inclusion through health and wellness clinics, population-based screening in NCD. And in 2021, one new component was added in the NPCDCS program, that is non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. The certain objectives of the NPCDCS programs are starting with the health promotion through behavioral change, then screening, population-based and opportunistic screening, prevention and control of chronic NCDs is the backbone of the NPCDCS program. We are also conducting the capacity building at various levels and supporting the diagnostic and the therapeutic at all levels. To do so, we have infrastructure of NPCDCS starting from the state and union territories. There are NCD cell, which do the administrative, which is the administrative headquarter, and 36 in number, followed by the district NCD cell, which is the administrative unit in the districts. There are 678 district NCD cell across the country, followed by the district NCD clinic, which are primary providing the care, NCD care. We have 643 district NCD clinic across the country. And the cardiac component of the NAP, of the NPCDCS program is taken care by the cardiac care units. There are 190 cardiac care units across country. And to tackle the cancer part, there is district daycare centers, 239 in number, providing the chemotherapy, and followed by 4,807 NCD clinic at CHC. So through this program, we starting from the grassroots level, from the doorstep of the population through population-based screening, joined by the referrals from community to sub-center, to PHC, CHC, and finally to tertiary centers, we are trying to maintain a continuity of care for the NCD patients. The population-based screening, as told earlier, was introduced in 2018. targeting mainly the age group more than 30 years. But if somebody other than this age group wants to be screened, they can directly drop in at the centers. But the frontline workers, ASHA and A&M, with the help of CBAC form, community-based assessment checklist form, they'll be focusing the age group above 30 years, and they'll be asking a set of questions and giving scores according to this, and will be referring. So population-based screening is also the first step where the population and the health center come in contact. So many sensitization activity, like from NAFLD point of view also, can be done at the grassroots level, at the CBAC form, at the population-based screening itself. So non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, as we know, is the buildup of extra fat in the liver cell, which is not caused by alcohol. So if a person not drinking alcohol may also develop abnormal fat in the liver because of the faulty lifestyle and unhealthy diet. It is normal to have some amount of fat in the liver. However, if it is more than 5 to 10% of the weight, it is called as the fatty liver or steatosis. As we all know, India is facing a huge burden of NCDs, and the burden of NAFLD is more than 30% of general population, with more than two-thirds of the diabetics have NAFLD. So with the help of already existing program NPCDCS and bringing small modification, we can cover this population, 30% of general population, with respect to awareness, with respect to treatment, because we are fortunate enough to have a program where there is interface between the population and the healthcare workers. So coming to the confluence of risk factor of NCDs and NAFLD, there are many risk factors which are in common, like metabolic syndrome, hypercholesterolemia, obesity, diabetes mellitus, physical inactivity, unhealthy diet, hypertension, and family history. So for NAFLD, if we take care of these factors, other NCDs will automatically will be taken care of. So that's why research, this is very well shown that taking care of NAFLD, targeting NAFLD, other NCDs can also be targeted. So Ministry of Health has already launched the operational guidelines for integration of NAFLD into NPCDCS which was finalized in collaboration with the NHSRC, ILBS, DGHS, and other partners. And for that, sensitization workshop has been already going on for the states and district nodal officers, medical colleges, and the series is still going on as for today also. So with the all preparation, NAFLD was launched on 22nd February by Honorable Health Minister Dr. Harshvardhan sir, and we are fortunate enough, in fact, we are the first in the world to identify the need for action for NAFLD and taken the action and included NAFLD in the already existing national program for NCDs. So coming to the implementation strategies. The implementation strategies are same for all programs, but when we customize it for NAFLD, like for health promotion, starting from the doorstep itself, from population-based screening, opportunistic screening, and which is scored by ASHA A&M through CBAC form, then jointly referred to the PHC, CHC, district hospital for timely and affordable diagnosis as well as the treatment. So the promotion and prevention activity with the NAFLD, as already told, with the health promotion strategy, sensitizing the population from the grassroots itself, then in the mass media, social media, including the messages for healthy liver through the ministry platform and all social media platform, and then celebrating international and national health days. Like for example, in April 19, we have just celebrated the World Liver Day with the international partners, WHO, and ILBS was also part of it. Then with the meeting sensitization workshop, we are trying to disseminate the information not only to the population, but also the health functionaries. Now coming to the community level activities, the activities are already going on under NPCDCS program. Along with that, like ASHA through CBAC form is already taking the abdominal obesity, And with few more history taking, family history, she can also give score and do the risk assessment and then refer it to the higher center, the sub center. There is no overburdening of Asha. She has already been doing all these activities. The data is there, the information is there. We are already trying to use that information with the lens of NAFLD. So at PHC also, the medical officer will be taking the patient directly coming as well as the patient coming through the population-based screening. We'll be taking the history, we'll be assessing the risk, and we'll refer to the higher center, CHC and CD clinic. The reporting forms and the recording forms are already there under NPCDCS with slight modifications, slight inclusion of NAFLD in it. We can do the same reporting and monitoring with that. At CHC level also, along with the already activities going on under NPCDCS, over and above that, we are also trying to include certain investigations such as LFT, CBC, and through public lab facilities, or in some states, there are already schemes for investigation, like in Bihar, there is under the name of CM, there are certain package of lab investigation going on. So at the CHC level, with the help of these small investigation, LFT, CVC, the medical officer there can put it in an app, in a mobile app, and calculate the FIB4 score, the NFS score, and do the risk stratification, according to which can refer the patient higher up or give the advice at his level. So for that, a capacity building, we are also trying for capacity building at various levels. And the form 3, which is for CHC, will also include a component of NAFLD in it for reporting and referral to the higher center. Then coming to the district hospital level, at a district hospital level also, the patient can directly drop in, or it can come via CHC or through population-based screening referral. So at a district hospital level, the risk stratification, if not done earlier, can be done, as well as there are more advanced investigation can be conducted there, like FibroScan. FibroScan, the states can ask for FibroScan and other equipment through the proposal in PIPs, as they make the PIP, that is program implementation planning. Through that, they can propose in the center for equipments like FibroScan, and the recording and reporting referral, again, with the help of the NPCDCS forms only, with inclusion of NAFLD component in it. So till here, we discussed the domain of National Health Mission. But the care doesn't stop here. The patient care is continued at the medical college level and the central government institute. So where higher care and a more investigation point of view and treatment point of view is available, like FibroScan is a specialized ultrasound machine for liver. It measures the fibrosis, scarring, and steatosis of the liver. If medical officer is at district and there is also medical college nearby, then we can strengthen or we can equip the medical colleges more with the FibroScan and for the diagnosis and treatment. As for NAFLD point of view, the treatment and diagnosis mainly occurs at the gastro department. If it is not available, then Department of Medicine can also we can do the capacity building and can also take care of that. So in future, to handhold the implementation of NAFLD, there is we are hoping for a National Center of Excellence for the national guidelines and training modules and designing dissemination IC material. Along with that, there are certain regional center of excellence for implementation of national guidelines for diagnosis, treatment, and translating in the local language and disseminating the plan of IEC. So national multi-sectorial action plan, we have been already conducting from the at ministry, where it has been well known that combating NCD is not only through health centers, but other stakeholders should also be involved to face the challenge of NCDs. So with the goals and vision already carrying out for this, the strategies and the key outcomes are already there. We only have to see it through the glasses of NAFLD to identify the areas where we can work according to NAFLD and put it there. So the promotive strategies are also already going on, like the Fit India movement launched by our Honorable Prime Minister in 2020 for Fit India age appropriate fitness protocols, the Eat Right campaign also already going on. So if we eat right, if we exercise right, we can obviously keep our liver very right. So till now we have done so much, but the way forward, the long way has to still go for the implementation of NAFLD along with the NPCDCS. There is a media plan sensitization workshop already going on, the inclusion of operational guidelines and the PIP guidelines with the making the FMR codes for the PIP is still going on. For the district has to, the states has to ask for, propose their PIPs according to the program, what is the equipment, diagnostics and medicine. And along with that, we are also trying it, the ministry, for the capacity building, training modules and the monitoring. Most important thing is the monitoring through the forms, through including NAFLD as a component in the already existing NPCDCS form. So with this, this is the all. We traveled from 1975 to 2021 with the addition of NAFLD component in the NPCDCS program. I hope we are able to implement also so well as we have achieved it so far. The operational guidelines have been disseminated in the states through SNOs, principal health secretaries, MDNHM. And this is all I have, I got to say. Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity. Thank you, ma'am.